or to have to address what we're doing.
And let me ask you a slightly different kind of question. You come from more of a libertarian background. The libertarians, as I understand, believe in free market capitalism. Couldn't a lot of what's happening be essentially the enforcement arm of runaway capitalism versus just being called straight fascism and control?
Well, I don't believe capitalism, the way it was set up, is really free market. I mean, it believes in these big titans, these robber barons, that are like these hurricane forces that suck everything in and drive, you know, the race to the bottom. I don't believe that multinational corporations, of the 100 biggest economies, what, 44 of them are companies now. And they have gotten together, really in an organized crime syndicate fashion, like pirates, very piratical, to go in and wreck economies, blow out economies, so they can buy everything up for pennies on the dollar. So I think these terms like communist or capitalist, all of this confuses the issue. From my research, it really is just a question of liberty versus tyranny. And whatever system you want to call it, I want more liberty, more individual choice, more community, more local control, more things being produced and made here, you know, more education for the population, more opportunities. And whatever you want to call that, put a label on it, that's the opposite of what we're getting with these multinational corporations that are criminal. They are not free market. They come in, they pay off politicians, they get more corporate welfare than anybody. Hell, they've got communism for themselves. They come take our wealth and then they share it communally amongst themselves. So again, all these terms, I mean, I really think it just gets down to the basics of, I'm against centralization. I'm against any type of centralization where power is centralizing through this bullying force. And that's what we're facing. But 9/11 was also an attempt by the elite to kind of push the masses back under their control, under their black wings, under their dark system, to scare us into submission. And I think America and the world has woken up from this coma, this spell that we were put under, like Sleeping Beauty, and now the sleeping giant is rising, and the elite are very scared. I see a lot of the hubris draining from their faces. I see them beginning to become fearful, and they should be fearful, because every tyrant, every tyranny throughout history has eventually fallen, and this tyranny has overreached way too far. The 9/11 fraud has been imploded. It is collapsing. The hoax is being revealed. You know about the major polls, 68% believing there's a cover-up, 42% believing it's an inside job in a Zogby poll, 36% believing it's an inside job in a Scripps Howard News Service, and I believe those numbers are a lot larger from people I've talked to on the streets of America and interviews I've done. So we're winning, and the good news is our enemies are beginning to panic, and they're making more and more rash decisions. That's why they're now trying to escalate us into World War III with Iran as a kind of Ponzi scheme. They're failing in Iraq, so go ahead and pump it up, make it even bigger, and move it on to the next level. But now that's short-circuiting. Israel failed with what they were trying to do in Lebanon. We know it's come out even in the New Yorker magazine, Cy Hirsch, with sources inside that Dick Cheney said the president sees this as the curtain razor in Lebanon. That failed miserably. So, Hugo Chavez has defeated the Free Trade Area of the Americas, which is really the Pan-American Union. That's been set back many years. In the European Union, expansion was defeated last year. So we're having victory after victory after victory. But we're never going to hear the mainstream press tell us we're having victory, but we know we're having victory from all of the key indices.
But particular incident, what particular fact, where is the biggest chink in the armor of the government story that you think the entire story will explode upon?
I really think it's the history. When you have Operation Northwoods, where the government says, we'll hijack planes and crash them, we'll bomb D.C., we'll commit sniper attacks in Miami and D.C. and blame patsies and how to set up patsies, when you read that, and then and that's totally declassified, and then you see that they did implement Operation Ajax, and they did stage the Gulf of Tonkin, and I was even watching Frontline a few weeks ago in a hotel room, and they were admitting what I'd known for years, that Nixon wanted to stage attacks and attack his own convention. I mean, this is all coming out. I think once you show people that Hitler did it, and Stalin did it, and Putin's been caught doing it in 99 during his election campaign, once you realize that it's happened over and over again, and people have been caught doing it, then you look at 9/11. You look at the impossibility of the official story, and I really don't think there's one simple point other than the fact that the official story, if you look at it, is a fraud, and then once people realize that, it collapses. And I would add the caveat that I really think what finally woke people up more than anything is the fact that Bush and his cronies didn't just accidentally get bad intelligence on Iraq. We now have the White House memo, the Downing Street memo. We know without a shadow of a doubt it's incontrovertible proof, we have the memos, that Bush simply said, fix the intelligence, make it up, we're going to war. And so people know that they took us to war. We've now lost more soldiers in Iraq than we've lost here in the United States on 9/11. We just passed that point a few weeks ago. And so people know if they'll lie about a war, and in the White House memo they talk about flying U.S. planes, painted up like the U.N. low, trying to get Saddam Hussein to shoot him down. They talk about having informants or defectors claim they saw WMDs. Excuse me. This is all there. This is there for everyone to see. And so over and over again, people are finding out that they've been lied to. And the no-bid contracts and Enron and all of it, this is a criminal administration.
Alex, we've got midterm elections coming up. Do you believe that any change in Congress is going to help expose this? Or do you think it's just going to be more of the same, perhaps now back to the Democrats?
Well, that's a complex question. I believe that we need to remove the Republicans from office. And even Congressman Ron Paul from Texas, who's anti-war and a libertarian, has said that it would be good if Bush lost control of Congress. And why is that? The Founding Fathers put in separation of powers. And you do not want a would-be tyrant, someone who says that he wants us to be a dictatorship, be a heck of a lot easier so long as he's the dictator. You don't want that madman having control of the legislative, the executive, and the judiciary, which he now does, including a majority of the governors and Supreme Courts at the state level as well. So we've never seen such a unified front in U.S. history, really since the Civil War, by the central government. Bush has almost total control. And it is so important to remove as many Republicans as possible and to put Democrats in, and then it will allow the Democratic constituency, which is a traditional, more anti-war, pro-peace community, to then force the Democrats that we've now elected to do the right thing and start impeachment proceedings. And a lot of experts in Congress on both sides of the aisle believe that if the Democrats win the House or the Senate, and it's going to happen if they win both, that impeachment proceedings will begin against George Bush on the area of lying about intelligence to go to war with Iraq. So we are very, very close to being able to bring down the tyrant. Now, they've raced to put in their electronic voting machines, but only 35% of the country now have them. We know that they are stealing elections coast to coast, but if there is a landslide, a tidal wave against these fascists, they're going to be out of office, and this is going to be a great victory. We'll still have the leadership of the Democratic Party and the leadership of the Republican Party, owned by the International Crime Syndicate, the New World Order. But it will be a major blow in this battle against them and will slow down their efforts greatly.
Alex, what would be a call to activism you could give to our viewers to help them get more involved in making a political change and a change for the better in our country?
Well, the establishment tells us, be nice, be quiet, don't sling mud. But then you watch the big candidates, they do fight nasty. We need to get aggressive about our freedoms, aggressive about our country, aggressive about our world, get in their face. And for folks out there watching, you don't have to have it all figured out or be perfect in your presentation. Just get out there. Now is the time for the maximum effort on the web, calling into radio shows, letters to the editor, getting out on the streets. Now is the time. We're at a major crossroads. So much is happening right now that will affect the entire future of our world. Right now is the key. More is going to happen in the next year in history than will happen in the next 10 years. Many experts believe that, and I believe that. Now is a critical point in history, so we've got to have the maximum effort of everybody across the political spectrum right now to defend liberty and resist tyranny.
Alex, where can we hear you on the radio?
Well, I'm on AM and FM stations around the country, around 60, and they can always go to Infowars.com or PrisonPlanet.com. We have free audio streams there. We also have a free daily podcast of the 3-hour radio program.
Alex, once again, thanks for being here.
Thank you.